are you?
Hey. I'm good, thank you. How are you?
I am very good. And lots of love from Singapore to Hong Kong. You know, good to see
and
you.
Back to you.
So well. Okay, to everyone who's listening to us, welcome to Everyday Conversation with Everyday People. Today, I'm talking to my dear, dear friend all the way from Hong Kong, Eslyn. And I actually just found out from her that she's a chartered psychologist. I never knew that there was such a term, you know. And Eslyn, thank you so much for talking to us, you know, today, right? We are actually on the last series of our conversation. And you are our final two conversationalists. I will have one more tomorrow and we are done, you know. So in this conversation series, we are dealing with this big topic called overcoming, because I think a lot of people are really going through very, very tough times, you know. So actually, I want to throw you quite a tough one, I think, you know, because I've been mulling over this. I just want to know, Eslyn, you know, I mean, in your professional opinion, do you see a difference between a person being stressed and a person, you know, having an anxiety attack? Do you see a difference?
I mean, definitely between stress and anxiety. Stress usually has an external factor, right? We're stressed about something happening. We're stressed about the amount of pressure at work. We're stressed about our deadlines. We're stressed about our relationship, maybe. Whereas anxiety has that additional factor of, I guess you could call it perpetual worry. So you're always worried about what will the future hold? What about the stuff you did in the past? How can that affect you? Or what are people thinking of you? So anxiety is really more an uncertainty, a real worry about what's going to happen, or a real worry about you know, different things that are going on for you. So it's slightly different in stress. I mean, stress has a lot of stress is often pressure, and it affects us a lot just because, you know, things are going on for us. There might be expectations and outcomes. So stress is often a sense around that, right? Whereas anxiety is really more that worry, that uncertainty. Now, also to keep in mind, anxiety is a diagnosable clinical issue. You can have an anxiety disorder, for example, including things. Yeah, so you can have an anxiety disorder that will then include things like perpetual worry, and there's a bunch of things around anxiety disorder that could make it clinical, right? So the fear of leaving the house could be something, really constantly worrying about things, having these ruminative, repetitive kind of thoughts that you find very difficult to switch off. Those are all kind of things of anxiety. And speaking about an anxiety attack, there's a lot of physiology going on as well. There's a lot of like your sympathetic nervous system gets activated, right? So you might be finding your heart rate going up. You might be sweating a lot. You might even be trembling. You might feel full of adrenaline. Those are all things that could link to anxiety. And if you're going as far as a panic attack could feel like you're actually dying, you know? Yeah. So it can be like your throat's closing up, you can't breathe, you know, your heart's pounding in your chest. Quite often people feel like they're having a heart attack. So that's really at the other end, the other extreme of the spectrum. Stress is more trigger-based. So, you know, something that's happened in your life that causes some stress and you need to now go and solve it. So it's quite a different thing, stress and anxiety.
I see. Oh dear. I didn't know that, because, you know, obviously, you know, with the lockdown and everything and people working from home, you know, the hours of working from home is so long, and it's like back to back. Zoom meetings like this, back to back to back, you know,
exhausting.
And I think that a lot of my friends are telling me that they are so stressed out. But, you know, sometimes I sense a little bit more than stress. So now I understand. I think a lot of people are unknowingly slipping into this realm of being anxious, isn't it? So, you know, Eslyn, I think that I think that it's important that we know how to differentiate the two and deal with it, right? Mm. So is there something that we can do to basically deal with, you know, the anxious feeling, or you know, how can we tell the difference between the two, and then therefore how can we deal with it?
Well, I mean, telling the difference between the two, it may not be the priority here, to be honest. It might be rather to just acknowledge that something's going on. It's not so much about labeling. Is it stress? Is it anxiety? Because ultimately, both of them are not great for our well-being. And quite often, they're very closely interlinked anyway. You might be stressed about one specific thing in your life, but that may cause anxiety about lots of other things, about the future and so on. So really, it's more about recognizing what's going on for you emotionally, being able to pause and step back and reflect. So if you start feeling, you know, the physiological symptoms, maybe there's a tingling in your tummy, or you might be having these thoughts you can't shut off and they keep coming back, or you might just be feeling anxious. So really stepping back and saying, okay, where does this come from? You know, what's the origin of that anxiety? And quite often we think we're anxious about the future. So with COVID, for example, we might be anxious about the future and what that's going to hold. But our future anxiety is very closely linked to our past experiences. So, for example, we might have money anxiety about the future because in the past we've experienced a time where we have been struggling for money, you know, or right, where we right. felt helpless. Right. And so the anxiety isn't about what's going to happen in that sense, but it's about what we think is going to happen based on, or what we're fearful is going to happen based on our experience in the past. So really reflecting on what am I actually frightened of? And then, of course, there's a lot of other things you can do. You can do physical breathing exercises. You can do things like meditation to kind of calm your mind. And there's a lot of different things that look at balance as well. So finding balance in your life, because if you're constantly anxious, that would be restless energy that you might want to get out by going for some exercise or, you know, speaking to your friends. So we talk about, you know, five areas that are important for our well-being. One being positive emotion, one being engagement. So really engaging with something that's intrinsically joyful for us. And that could be something as simple as painting an image, creating a painting, doing a puzzle, playing with the kids or playing with our pets. That's something that gives us intrinsic joy. And then we've got relationships, social relationships that are super important. Our partnerships, our friendships, our family relationships, anything that makes us feel connected. And then we've also got the area of meaning. So doing something meaningful in our lives, having a sense of purpose, being needed, feeling like we're contributing. And then also a sense of achievement. So, you know, trying to strive forward in our careers, building our business, whatever it might be. Now, all of these things are currently affected by COVID. But if we try and sort of keep that balance, work on our physiology, work on our breathing, slowing all these things down a little bit, and just being aware of what we're actually frightened of, that can really help us to manage our anxiety a little bit in these uncertain times that we're living in. Yeah.
That's great. You know, actually, coming back to a little bit more of a personal note, you know, I know you're an animal rescuer, you know, and I think it's brilliant because, you know, some of my friends who basically does that, right, I see that it helps to keep them sane in this very challenging times, you know. So I just want you to...
Hard to believe.
Yeah, I just want you to talk a little bit about that because... You know what, actually, animals, maybe to some people, it's really the answer, you know, to anxiousness. I don't know. Yeah, I think so. What do you think?
Yeah, no, absolutely. Companion animals can have a great calming sensation. Stroking and petting animals can release oxytocin. So that's our love hormone, if you so will, right? So, and that makes us feel good and connected and safe and happy. So yeah, absolutely. And you know, there's animal assisted therapy programs even where people work with dogs and horses to help manage anxiety and depression and a lot of other clinical disorders as well. I find it hard to believe that people say they're staying sane during animal rescue, because but it is very meaningful work. It can be quite frustrating because, you know, surprisingly, you are dealing, or maybe not surprisingly, but you are dealing with a lot of people, right? When you're working with animals, when you're trying to deal with animal welfare, animal rights, you always have to factor in the people element, the human element to it. So I'm not sure if that keeps anyone so super happy and chirpy, but it's certainly very rewarding, yeah.
That's good to know. Actually, I have quite a lot of, animal activist friends like yourself. Mm-hmm. And I do see that they balance it out quite nicely, you know, because a lot of them also have very demanding work, you know. So, I mean, you know, Aslin, when we have great conversation, the time really flies. So I just want to sneak in the last point, you know, what do you think? How then can we achieve some level of balance, if you like, you know, and not go down that road of anxiety, which is obviously is very dangerous. So what can we do to balance it out, you know, in this very challenging time?
Sure. I don't think we need to avoid anxiety. I think it's more about sitting with the emotion and understanding why it's there and seeing what we can use it for. You know, all emotions have some sort of information for us, and quite often we tend to ignore that information. So it's much more valuable to go, okay, I feel anxious, let me reflect on that for a moment and spend some time with ourselves to understand what's going on. That's really important. I also think when change is forced upon us, which unfortunately has happened with COVID, a lot of change has been forced upon us, right? And so we get angry and depressed, you know? And I think that looking at that change and finding a way to take ownership of the change can help. Because anytime you feel someone else is putting change on you, you kind of have a knee-jerk reaction, right? You're like, mm-mm, I don't like this, because we feel out of control. So if in these uncertain times, there's a way of making us feel back in control, of looking at the change and creating the change we want to see. Because quite often in life, there's stuff that we want to see different and stuff that we want to see changed, but we get used to our comfort and we don't want to make that step because it's effortful and uncertain. And now COVID has forced us, you know, to do that. So we can really take the opportunity to take ownership of that change, to create the change we want to see, you know, and use it as an opportunity for growth. And rather than just something that we're the victim of. And I think that can really help during that change process and during this time of uncertainty.
Yeah, indeed. And well said. So Aslin, thank you very much on that note, you know, for joining me all this way from Hong Kong on my virtual sofa. You know, I hope that next time when I see you, just like the last time when I was in Hong Kong, that we can have a drink together.
Yes.
Oh my God, I miss that place, you know. And it was so nice to see you. Indeed, right? Okay, so to everyone who's listening in, I hope you learned something, you know, from our conversation. And if you like to be connected to Aslin, please write in to us at www.elvishideout.com. And we will definitely be connecting you guys, okay? So on that note, stay safe, Aslin, and to the next time.
And to you.
Hopefully we'll meet again soon. Bye.
Sounds good. Take care. Bye-bye.